here at United Methodist Church. And if you lose, you'll find a book at the end, one end of it, and you just write your name and email or address, phone number. Please do that and pass it down. It's important for visitors to do that so we can get a hold of you to let you know what we have going on in the life of Western Hills United Methodist Church. Announcements. Well, I did go first.
We will be here for the concert at 4 o'clock and the choir at 6:30 on Wednesday. Thank you.
Hello.
As Debbie has said, our recital is finally here tonight at 4 o'clock. Please be here. I'm very excited. I got to rehearse, and thank you for allowing me to change up the setting a little bit. I promise next week it'll be back to normal. If you would like to join me, please, it's at 4 o'clock today here in the sanctuary. I would really love for you all to be here so I can properly thank you for everything you have done for me here. Thank you.
Additional announcements. Worship King Nini is right after worship at 12:30. It's going to be in the inspiration room, I believe, so we're planning on it. Other announcements is Heavenly Needles at 1:30 p.m. Tuesday, 7 p.m. is welcome to be in if you want to be long back to group. Just please come. Ministry Safe next Sunday at 12:30. That's everyone that belongs to the Ministry Safe Committee, which is our Sunday school teachers and leadership in the church. You know who you were, all. So, in confirmation class next Sunday at 4. I understand the meeting at 4 today, but they're going to be joining us in the recital, women's recital. So, everybody will be here. I'm sure everybody here right now will be here this afternoon at 4 o'clock. Here's a beautiful meeting. Let's prepare our hearts for worship.
Thank you.
grace of Jesus Christ be with you all.
Lord, world of grace and a world of selfishness. But in this world of contrast, God remains the same. Always true to God's nature, a God whose property is mercy. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. And now something new, as signs of God's reconciliating love, let us greet one another where you're at. Greet the person next to you, in the name of Jesus Christ. The peace of Christ be with you.
Somebody speaking to you.
children.
Amen.
Please join me in the prayer of invocation. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. First reading comes from the New Testament, 1 John chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know Him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this: when He is revealed, we will be like Him, for we will see Him as He is. And all who have this hope in Him purifies Himself, just as He is pure. Everyone who commits sin is guilty of lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that He was revealed to him take away sins. And in Him there is no sin. No one who abides in Him sins. No one who sins has either seen Him or known Him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Everyone who does what is right is righteous, just as He is righteous. Peace be with you. They were startled and terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. And He said to them, why are you frightened? Why do you doubt arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones as you see that I have. And when He had said this, He showed them His hands and His feet. While in the joy they were disbelieving and still wondering, He said to them, have you anything here to eat? They gave Him a piece of boiled fish, and He took it and ate in their presence. Then He said to them, these are my words that I have spoken to you while I am still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled. Then He opened their minds to understand the scripture, and He said to them, thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in His name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you.
be acceptable unto thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our deliverer. Amen. There is a splendor to that. A splendor that brings, as the GE commercials would say, good things to life. I flew once into New York City at LaGuardia. It was nighttime, and the splendor of watching the skyline of Manhattan from an airplane was just unbelievable, beautiful, extraordinary. There is a splendor to light. Have you ever been in a darkened room that is new to you? And for some reason you get up to turn on the light, but have no notion as to where the switch is. And you search for it frantically until you find the switch. And when you find it, you flip it on, and then your heart comes to rest. There were many times at Arlington Heights when I stayed late. And just like our church has three distinguishable buildings, education, office complex, and sanctuary, there was the East Educational Building, the oldest building in the complex. It was from that building that the first sanctuary was built. And there were pictures back in the 1940s during World War II where you could almost tell that this was a military church full of soldiers and officers of the armed forces worshiping at Heights. And at night, you had a switch on top and a switch in the bottom. You were caught in the in-between floors. You would take the steps in darkness. It helps to know the layout of a building. Then you can do it in darkness. But when you have no notion as to where you are, everything is new, everything is strange. Once you find that switch, that electrical switch, you give thanks to God. I know that Bo understands this, and so does Jerry Newman, this concept of electricity and energy that brings things to light and to life. One of these days, we will have our light at full 100%. If you look up on the roads that are not working, and we thank God for the natural light that illuminates our building. It's wonderful to be in a lit place. Have you ever been in an arena, a basketball arena, when it is empty and dark? And you walk and you wonder where the light switch is. And then all of a sudden the lights come on and you feel yourself and hear your presence of something wonderful, something overpowering, something majestic, the splendor of light. It is said that as astronauts work in the space station, they have noticed something about Earth, and that is that as they look around space, Earth is the most majestic body orbiting the sun. As we see it from afar and we see pictures, we see a planet that has blues and white the blue of oceans and the white of clouds, and from afar it looks majestic. But did you know that there is a side that is lit, that's day, and a side that is dark, that is night? There's something majestic, beautiful that happens when light breaks through and we're able to see our world, our home, our place. So it is in the Epistle of John to recognize that the light that is shed on this particular passage from 1 John is a passage in which we are asked to open our eyes, to open our minds, and recognize the truth that we, as created beings, are all children of God. Now, sometimes in our religiosity, we tend to distinguish children of God and creatures of God. And we tend to say that the children are those who believe and the creatures are the unbelievers. I tend to try to understand this passage along the lines that if we are created by God and for God, we are all children of God. It helps to be in the light. It helps to recognize and see the distinction. But we are all children of God. This is an important fact. It's an important fact because as long as we separate ourselves by tribe and by nation, by wealth, by poverty, as long as we separate ourselves, we see others less than us. But God in Christ Jesus, the Word that has become flesh, has put us all at level. At the level that because we are created by God, we are children of God. Sometimes obedient and sometimes disobedient. Sometimes knowing it, sometimes because we're ignorant. But the fact that we are children of God is an important truth. You may ask, why is this truth so important? It is so important because it guides and governs how we relate with God. I had an interesting call. The call came from a woman who uses Uber. She uses Uber because she doesn't have transportation. And she was calling me because she had a great, great concern. And I asked, what is your concern? She says, did you know that many of the Uber drivers are Muslim? I said, no, I don't use Uber, but if you say so, that's what you have experienced. Says that makes me feel quite afraid. Why are there so many Muslims? She remarked. I said, well, they happen to be people that live in our community with a faith in God that's different from ours, the Christian faith. Did you know that he tried to recruit me? I said, he did? Well, what did he do? He asked me to come to his mosque. And I said, well, he might have asked you to come at a different time because women and men pray separately. She says, but then I asked her a question. I said, if you're so concerned about there being too many Muslims, and that the Muslim faith is growing, did you witness to him about your Christian faith? Did you share with him the good news of Jesus Christ? Oh no, I just didn't know what to say or how to say it. We are all children of God because we are all God's creation. And all of us, regardless of color, regardless of ethnic origin, we're all blessed with the life of God that propels us to experience the world and live in this world hoping to thrive in it. But all of us know that we all strive in it. So when I look at a Muslim, I say, dear God, I have all these preconceptions of being afraid, of them being different from me, of me being different from them. Help me to relate in a way that is Christian. And what do you think is the Christian way of relating with a Muslim person? The Christian way of relating with a Muslim person is to be inclusive of the other, affirming that they have a right to life, and they have a right to believe, whether they are Muslim, Buddhist, Hindus, or whatever the tag may read. I hope that we have the tag that says, I am a child. You know what has become of our faith as I have experienced it? I think of my relationship with God as a church member. And by that I'm saying I belong to a club. Rather than to think of my relationship with God as one that places me in relationship to the kingdom of God, that opens up itself, proclaims. What does it proclaim? It proclaims Christ. It proclaims the good news. It proclaims inclusion and concern and care. The minister was asked to go to a home of one of his members. The minister knew that this particular person cannot care for themselves. And so, trying to find the key at dusk to enter the home was difficult. A neighbor came by wondering what the minister was doing. Maybe the minister was trying to break in. And so the minister quiets the person and says, I'm this person's pastor. He says, can I help you? The minister says, I can't find the key. He says, he finds the key and opens the door. Because of this person's inability to care for themselves, you could say that the place is stretched out. You could say that no one in dignity, human dignity, is the servant of such an ambience and environment. The question is, will the splendor of light, will the truth revealed of what is needed compel this person, this patient, to help themselves and to allow others to help them? a concern should arise, not because I like this person or dislike, not because this person has done favors for me or this person will be do favors for others in my name. Totally the concern should always be out of a Christian faith, because this person is a child of God. I, as a child of God, will do all in my power to help this person out. That's the power of faith. That's the power of living. That's the power of recognizing that God leads. And where God leads, God sheds light. And where light is shed, it reveals. And when things are revealed, we are asked to respond. And what I told the caller, the problem with us Christians is that we hear about it, we say, oh my God, and we move on, hoping not to be called to respond to the need. What we know is this, when He is revealed, we will be like Him, for we shall seek Him as He is. There is no question in our mind or in my mind when God in Christ Jesus invites us to participate in the mission of transforming lives of others. Never should it say it's another person's responsibility. When God sheds God's light on a problem, He is sharing this problem with us and inviting us to be part of the solution, part of the response. And all who have this hope in purify themselves just as He is pure. Over the week, I ministered to a family whose 96-year-old father was about to die. And in visiting the room and overhearing the conversations, I heard of their respect and their love for James Spencer. He grew up in a family of crop sharers in Oklahoma. He moved to Amarillo. He moved to Houston. He moved to Mathis in the Panhandle. And finally, as an older gentleman, comes to live with one of his sons. And the way they spoke about James was to celebrate his honesty, his industry, his purity as a person who always looked for the best in people. And I came to the conclusion of hearing the witness from the family about a good person, a good person. Why do we come to church? Why do you have to listen to my sermons? I asked the confirmation class, which was the most boring moment in worship, and they told me to preach. And I said, well, tell me, why is it so boring? They can tell me, but I answered before them. I said, it's because I go above you. I'm not speaking to you. And I think they understood. But I hope that their presence and in listening to this sermon allows them to understand, and more than anything, to think of what is the truth and how should I respond to it through my living and through my witness, especially my Christian witness. So what do we say to people who are different from us, who believe differently from us. They're children of God, deserving respect, deserving dignity, and to a certain degree, as we live side by side, to recognize that there are many things that we can do together. And even in our faith tradition differences, we may be able to subtly give witness to the truth of Christ. What is to be has not yet been revealed. But when he is revealed, we will know him as he is. And this hope of encountering through the splendor of light the risen Christ will propel us to believe and give us a foundation from which to express and give witness to our story. Then it is up to us to relate to each other, not as different, not as indifferent, but to relate to each other with the grace of Jesus Christ our Lord, expressing to others the love of God and doing this in the power of the Holy Spirit. Thanks be to God, now and forevermore. Amen.
If you're able, please stand for joining in the affirmation of faith. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is one true church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith let us now declare. We believe in God the Father, and in his wisdom, power, and love, whose mercy is over all the world, and whose will is ever directed to his children's good. We believe in Jesus Christ, Son of God,
people who have asked for prayers. There is kingdom, and at the end I will say, Lord, in mercy, and which you respond, hear our prayer. We pray for Louis Atterbury, for Renee Brown, who is here with us, for Dorothy Burton, who continues to rehab, for Catherine Busby, who also rehabs, for Penny Camparini, who is in hope, for Lady Elrod, bowing and looking beautiful, for Pete Gutierrez, the brother who suffered from a heart attack and is recovering, for Charity Hill, Linda Eden's grandmother, for Ken Beach, who had knee replacement surgery, for Laola Allison Lester. We have missed Margaret Lester. She is in New York City with her daughter, Denise. For Mike McKee, for Jane McGoodwin, who continues to rehab at home, for Fanny Hamilton, also rehabbing at home, Tyler Robinson, to the family of James Spencer, who died yesterday at the age of 96 years old. The services are pending, and for Sarah Wanderer.
Something I want to share with you that I think is important to the whole world. And I came up here without conferring with Rob because it was on my heart and mind. My daughter's at drill this weekend, you know, she's still in the guard. At 11:11 p.m. on Friday night, she texted me and said, Trump has just declared war on Syria. 2013, Barack Obama sent 250,000 American soldiers to Syria. Now, actually, according to the Constitution, the president has no right to declare war. Congress does, but it's been let go. What I want is for us to be aware, and I'm just asking for prayers for our leaders, for our countrymen, for those who are in a place of decision making, for us to be able to see what's going on and to have peace if that's possible. And we can only do that if we all come together of one accord and get on our knees and pray. Pray without ceasing, says the Lord. So I am asking you, we of course know nothing of what's going to happen in the future. The Lord does. He has a plan, he says, for each one of us and for us. And our goal will be to pray for whatever the will of the Lord Jesus Christ is. So that is what I'm asking, along with the prayers of the rest that Rob has mentioned. Thank you for this time.
And it is the will of God. It is the will of God for us to live in peace. With that in mind, putting all kind of partisan aside, let us pray. Let us pray silently, and then I'll pray the pastoral prayer. Most gracious and loving God, we, your people, come to praise you and to glorify your name for all purity and goodness are found in thee. Most gracious God, we live in a world of contrast, of different philosophies, of different political stances, but we entrust this world to your care, and we ourselves entrust ourselves to maintaining and preserving the gift of habitat that you have given to us. Around the world, there is much violence, much strife, much murder and death around the world. There are people today who are displaced, 100 and some thousand of miles from their habitat. For those who wander as refugees, most gracious and loving God, let the powers of the world who have the resources to respond, respond with compassion and respond with grace. Teach us, O God, to value our days, to value our time in this earth, that in our time in it, through our efforts, we may preserve it and we may care for it. Help us to be good stewards of the world you have given us. Help us to be good citizens, to do our part in the political world and the political sphere that we live in. Help us to be responsible. And help us as Christian people that all that we do and all that we say may be set forth in the light of your mercy and in the light of your love. These things, O God, we pray in the name of Jesus the Christ, he who taught us to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Thank you.
That is correct. Dear Lord, as we come today, we just praise you and thank you for your Son on the third Sunday of resurrection. We come to you, Lord, humbly, knowing that you have given us so much, that you have provided the resources that we can live and raise our families, our children, and give them what you want us to give them. Lord, there's so many in our community and around the world that are in need. And we come today to offer you a portion of what you have given us, that your ministry around the world and in our community may go forward. In your Son's name we pray. Amen.
sing our song of sending forth. We'll sing the first, and for the computer over there, the last stanza of the story to tell to the nation. I want to send you forth with this in mind. I was asked very poignantly, do you believe in the wall? And my response was very spontaneous. I said, no. But I believe in border security. So I want to acknowledge that there are different stances, political stances, thinking that we know the truth and we hope in God and we do stand in the truth. And that is where we come together to discern, to share, to sometimes even expose our ideologies. And in the Methodist Church, there is freedom. There is freedom. You can share it. Just be respectful of the other. And be respectful in such a way that you treat the other as a child of God. So, well, I want to say that it's a both ends proposition, and it's best when it is handled with care and with love and with compassion. Those are values and attributes that are Christian. So with that in mind, the first and the last stanza with a story to tell to the nations. Because we do, sometimes that story goes unheard.
Fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now.